It is my great pleasure to introduce to you Gráinne de Búrca as a distinguished speaker. She hardly needs any introduction. She is very well known, widely recognized in the field of European law and European studies. Everybody knows, everybody who is familiar with EU law knows the famous Gráinne de Búrca's textbook, one of the leading textbooks in the field of EU law, and many contributions and articles she has written on EU law. Her career has taken her through different positions. She is now a professor at New York University Law School, but previously she was a professor at Harvard, Fordham Law School, and here at the European University Institute in Florence. And actually, you were former director of the Academy of European Law. This is not a reason why we decided to invite you. We decided to invite you because you make a great contribution to the research and to the understanding of our field of research. So thank you very much. Thank you for accepting to give this opening lecture, and I give you the floor.
Okay, so good afternoon to everyone. I hope we haven't created a fire hazard here with the block. There's such heat, I can imagine spontaneous combustion arising this afternoon. So thanks to all of you for being here on such a steamy afternoon when there are so many other possible attractions in Florence, including swimming pools, air-conditioned bedrooms, and many others. It's a great pleasure to be back in Florence, to be back at the EUI, and especially to be back at the Academy. As Loic mentioned, I did previously work here within the Academy, and very fond memories of it, and also very fond memories of the summer courses particularly, which are the highlight of the Academy's calendar year, as you can imagine. And we're always astonished that so many interesting people from all over the world come together in when they're, again, in a beautiful place like Florence, when there's so much to do, and faithfully attend all the lectures and contribute. And one of the pleasures for me of having left Florence and moved around a lot, as you heard from Loic, is that I meet alumni, if we can call them that, of the Academy everywhere. And they say, oh, I remember the lectures in 19 whatever, and they're all doing such interesting things and have careers everywhere. So it's very nice to see that kind of Academy diaspora around the world. And I'm sure I'll meet some of you in years to come, or I hope I will, and hear what you're up to. So the topic on which I'm going to speak today, Europe's raison d'etre is what I would call it, is one on which I've been reflecting for a while now and have begun to write a little about, but I'm finding it a very challenging one, and I'm still thinking about it. So I look forward to hearing some of your reactions and questions in thinking this through further. My intention is not, you'll be happy to hear, to speak for an hour and a half. So I'll speak for about half of the time and then leave the rest of the time for a discussion and questions. So we all know that this is a very difficult time at present for the European Union. We're all used to the term crisis being applied to the EU, but this time it really feels like a crisis. And you know, it's 2012, it's 60 years since the foundation stones of the EU were laid with the coming to force of the European Coal and Steel Community in 1952. And up to about 3 years ago, if we were having the 60th anniversary of the EU, it would be a cause for, it would be a time for celebration. We would be talking about the achievements of the EU, its significant achievements, because there's been widespread agreement, I think, that the EU has been a significant, up till then, the EU has been a significant success in many respects. But now things feel under pressure in a different kind of way from ever before. But until the current crisis, despite many hiccups and many stops and starts in the course of European integration, Europe had, broadly speaking, if I was addressing you, say, 3 years ago, Europe had, broadly speaking, delivered on what Joseph Weiler called its three foundational goals. That is the delivery of peace, prosperity, and supranationality in Europe. In terms of peace, as we all know, it had not only bound together the states of post-World War II Europe in a political compact which made war between them unthinkable, but it had also, by the end of the century, achieved another of its founding goals, and that was the reuniting of Eastern and Western Europe after the fall of the Iron Curtain. In terms of prosperity, it had, through the single European market and the mobility of goods, labour, and capital, improved the standard of living for many Europeans and strengthened the European economy overall. In terms of supranationality, the EU had challenged the unbridled European nationalism of the past, of the first half of the 20th century in particular, by introducing a novel form of transnational political cooperation, something neither as thin as traditional international cooperation nor as demanding as federal union, which would encourage the development of mutual political trust, common interests, and the daily habits of deeply intertwined cooperation, practical cooperation between European states, even while not subduing their individual national identities. Of course, the path of European integration was not ever entirely smooth, as I've noted, and there were significant challenges always along the way. The cliché, and clichés are often truths, is that Europe, in fact, proceeds through crisis and has always proceeded through crisis. Crisis galvanized Europe into taking steps forward many times previously. For example, the political crisis and empty chair policy of the 1960s in the Luxembourg Accords prompted the European Court of Justice to develop the ideas of direct effect and primacy, which have been so central in the European legal construction. The period of legislative and policy stagnation of the 1970s led to the development of plans for the Single European Act and for later to EMU. The coming into power in a more minor crisis, but the coming into power of Haider in Austria in the late 1990s and early 2000 helped to galvanize and shape the beginnings of a real European human rights policy. The failure of the Constitutional Treaty led to the Lisbon Treaty and so on. So we see this fits and starts, crisis and momentum and so on, and we could think maybe we're there again. But there have been also more persistent challenges, like the rise of Euroscepticism, the rise of the far right in Europe, the disengagement of people from European political processes, and you know, the emergence of strongly anti-European parties from the 1990s onwards. And even if it seemed shocking to some in the last two of the recent Greek elections to see, you know, the Golden Dawn party being elected into the Greek parliament, you know, a party described by many as neo-Nazi. At the same time, the rise of the extreme right is a long-term secular trend in Europe, not something recent or caused only by the current economic circumstances. But really, the economic maelstrom convulsing Europe since 2007, the banking crisis, followed then by the sovereign debt crisis, is unquestionably, I think, the most severe and profound crisis that Europe has faced, the European Union has faced in its history to date in these 60 years. And it's become something of an existential crisis. So it's a question not just of whether the euro can survive, but also a question of whether the European Union will survive. And this is something I'm told by my friends and colleagues that I'm getting too American-centric. From spending too long in the US, I see it through the lens of the US media, according to which the EU is about to implode any day now. And when I come here, it's sort of faintly reassuring when I come to Europe, because there's the sense of business as usual. Everything is going along as usual. The European institutions, European classes, courses. From the other side of the Atlantic, it can tend to feel a little catastrophic at times. And I think the truth is probably somewhere in between, is my own sense. But at the same time, we're undoubtedly in a very severe crisis in wrenching economic circumstances for many in Europe. And I don't, it isn't my intention, or I certainly wouldn't have the ambition of trying to develop or defend any prediction as to whether the euro will survive or the EU will survive, or a blueprint for, you know, the ills ahead. So I'm not a psychic, I can't tell the future. I'm not an economist, so I can't explain the causes of the crisis. And I'm not a politician, so I can't propose concrete political solutions. So what I want to do instead is just to think a little bit about the current crisis and where we are, and the significance of the steps that have so far been taken to address the crisis, and then to use that to reflect on the broader question I want to address today, and that is, what is Europe's raison d'etre? what is the reason, the rationale for the European Union today. So 60 years on, less than a decade after, at the 60 years ago, less than a decade after the end of the Second World War, it was fairly clear at that stage what European integration was for, or what the primary leaders of the European integration project thought it was for. Nowadays, it is far less clear. It is far more difficult to get a clear sense, a consensus from people about what is the European Union project about today? What is it for? And this is very worrying in present. It's worrying anyway, but it's very worrying in present circumstances because, you know, unless the people of Europe, unless the citizens of the EU have some clear sense, idea about what the EU is for and why it matters, and what the process of integration is about and why it should be supported, then the very complex and painful task of getting the EU back on track and pulling out of the present crisis will be even more difficult. So why should people suffer great economic hardship, austerity, pain, and so on, in order to save the European Union and the euro, as we're being told today? So they're questions that are undoubtedly on people's minds today, ordinary people's minds, and not just academics and elites, as is so often the case. So the question of the raison d'etre of the EU remains, I think, very central. And when the Schuman Declaration was first written in 1950, and when the Coal and Steel Treaty was drafted, the project of European integration, as you said, had a clear raison d'etre then, and it had an economic, a political, and a security dimension. So the political dimension, the idea of having a more united European continent, in part in response to the wars that had shattered Europe, was one, but also the idea of binding the enemies, France and Germany, together into a close and irreversible political community. But there was an economic impetus, even at the time, a strong one, to stimulate and reinvigorate the damaged post-war economies of Europe and to bring about the benefits of closer trade and shared markets. And there was also a security dimension at the time, the construction of a united Europe in the face of the growing Soviet threat at the time. So these three were very clear, and there was a sense of why European integration was important and would make a difference and be of benefit to the states involved. And the benefits of integration has certainly been felt, including by those states that are suffering most economically at the moment, Greece, Spain, Portugal, Ireland, and so on. For many years before their current economic woes, they felt the benefits of European integration. And overall, Europe became a much more peaceful, prosperous, and politically integrated continent than it had been, in a different place from the war-torn continent of so many centuries. So partly as a consequence of this success, I think the challenge of thinking about the rationale or raison d'etre of the EU today is maybe even more complex. And I've divided it into sort of three challenges or three stages. So the first challenge is, as I've suggested in a way, is that European integration over time has largely delivered on the first three original promises. So the promises of peace, prosperity, and supranationality. But to such an extent that in a way these achievements, I think, have come to be taken for granted. They're viewed as commonplace. They're there, but they're just a fact of life. They don't in themselves provide the continuing rationale for European integration. The second challenge, I think, is that this taken for grantedness of the European Union's achievements hasn't sufficed to give it the kind of legitimacy that nation states enjoy, the taken for grantedness of the entity. So there are times when we're angry or upset as citizens with the conditions within the states that we live in, but that anger is generally directed at the government of the day and not at the existence of the state as an entity. So states enjoy, as entities, a basic kind of political support and legitimacy, and in the absence of some major calamity or schism, the unity and the existence of the state is not questioned. I mean, there are exceptions. We can see Scotland today, Quebec, Sudan, and so on. There, Kosovo. There are circumstances in which states do dissolve, and their identity and existence is questioned. But that's rare. And in general, once states deliver on certain basic public goods, their existence is not taken for granted. But the same is not true for the European Union. The attachment that citizens feel to their national political communities doesn't apply to their relationship as individuals to Europe or the EU. So for all that Europe has delivered on its three dimensions of peace, prosperity and supranationality in the past. Its existence and desirability as a political entity, the question of what it's for, why it exists and so on, is certainly not taken for granted, but remains very much alive still. So the EU's legitimacy seems to remain a kind of performance-based legitimacy. And the European Union is seen to make sense as long as it's delivering the goods on something, whatever that something might be. It doesn't gain credit, not significant credit, for having created a united and peaceful continent, but is always a political entity in question, struggling to justify itself. So I'll return to this problem again below of the EU's current attempt to justify itself. So this first challenge, just to recap, the first challenge, it's delivered on its original goals, but that didn't deliver a taken-for-grantedness that states enjoy. instead, we're in a situation where, you know, the EU's legitimacy is still in question. What's most acute about the current situation, I think, the problem that's most acute for the EU is that it's not only now that the existence of the EU is in question, what is it for now that it's delivered on its original goals, but the EU is now seen to be part of the problem. You know, we've come to a stage where it's not just that what is the EU for, but rather it has a negative, it's seen as having a negative impact on people's lives. It's perceived at in the current moment as being one of the agents, I think, of socioeconomic distress. It's not just not delivering prosperity, but it's imposing austerity. And it's seen as being a significant causal factor behind the economic and social pain being felt in many European states. By iron-casting the requirements of balanced budgets and debt reduction in the absence of deflationary options, EU policies are seen to severely limit the options of states which are facing growing unemployment and low or no growth. And the EU is therefore seen to be worsening the socioeconomic conditions of citizenship of citizens. So we've moved from a state where the EU began with a clear rationale and a mission and a sense of purpose to a situation where the EU fulfilled many of those original aims and goals, and yet its existence was not taken for granted and still questioned, to a situation where the EU is seen to be a part of the problem, you know, where the EU is something which people perceive as a negative factor in their lives rather than delivering anything positive, either at nation state level or more broadly at the European level. So, you know, the question is again, coming back, well, let me first quote something that the Finnish foreign minister recently said, which I thought was very interesting, that we've for long been saying we need to bring the EU closer to its citizens, and how will the EU being brought closer to its citizens, they're alienated. Well, the EU has been brought very close to its citizens, and they're feeling it now, but not in the way that was anticipated. You know, he said, the euro crisis hits because when it hits your wallet and you have to bail out other countries, suddenly the EU becomes a hell of a lot more interesting. He was describing the perspective from Finland, which is, of course, one of the states that's not feeling the crisis so much. Just a first comment on this idea, the current phase and the idea of the EU as a negative force and not a positive force anymore. The acute challenge to European integration posed by the current economic crisis is to remember that, you know, although the European Union's and, you know, Germany's and the European Central Bank's austerity policy at present is causing or exacerbating social and economic pain, it's not the same thing as saying that the European Union is the cause of the crisis. We all know that the causes of the crisis are multiple and complex and differ from state to state, and they include inadequate regulation of the banking sector, they include excessive speculation, and in some cases, significant public sector overspending. But I do think it's worth underscoring the fact that the causes of the crisis were at least as much a problem of reckless market behavior as profligate governments. But they were also exacerbated by a lack of trust in relation to some states' compliance with the stability pact rules underlying the euro. The problem now, though, is that whatever the causes of the crisis, the EU is certainly limiting the remedial measures that states can take in response to it. They can't, deflation is not an option, and the EU is, on the other hand, insisting on fiscal austerity. So this is where we stand today, and the problem is that we're confronted, broadly speaking, with two different directions for the EU, the direction of closer integration or disintegration, eventual disintegration. That's putting it starkly, but I think that's realistic, that there is a sort of a fork in the path that has been reached. The disintegration option, obviously, is the default scenario where the conditions imposed by the EU, by Germany, by the IMF, become impossible or unacceptable to a state, and it leaves the euro with all the consequences that would have for the state in question and for the rest of the EU and beyond. And then there's the other, is the closer integration option, which is the one that has so far been pursued tentatively by the EU, including in last week's summit, with the moves towards banking union. And that's to go further in the direction of fiscal and political union with the view to building in common safeguards against the likely occurrence of situations of the kind that gave rise to this crisis in the first place. Stronger bank and financial regulation, closer fiscal economic supervision, greater fiscal solidarity, and so on. So far, the steps have been incremental, building on what's already been done, but there's still steps in the direction of closer integration in the field of economic, monetary, and fiscal policy. And yet, the disintegration option remains a very real one, I think, despite the outcome of the elections in Greece and these gradual moves towards closer forms of integration. And for many, and I think maybe this is very speculative, maybe even for most Europeans, the disintegration option would be a very unwelcome one, not just because of the likely undermining or gradual undoing of the entire project of European integration and all the good that came with it, but also because of the immediate and medium-term economic upheaval and pain that it would bring, that disintegration and the breakup of the euro would bring. But on the other hand, the integration route, the strengthening of the EU by moving towards closer fiscal and political union, brings back the question of the EU's legitimacy and its raison d'etre centrally into focus. So the desire to avoid short-term or medium-term economic pain does not furnish a rationale for European integration in the longer term. It can't furnish that rationale. It may give the impetus now for something, but it doesn't actually furnish a good enough reason for creating, for the long term, a close European quasi-federal system that doesn't have the support of the people of the member states, of the EU's member states. So we had, you know, even before the economic crisis, we had this constant crisis of legitimacy of the EU, democratic legitimacy, political legitimacy, the sense of rising Euroscepticism and disaffection with the process of European integration and people not participating in European elections. So that suggests that even without the economic crisis, there was little popular or public consensus on the value of European integration and the raison d'etre of the EU. So let me take two separate issues. First, the question of the immediate steps being taken out of the current crisis. And the second, then, the bigger question, the raison d'etre question, the challenge of articulating what is the raison d'etre and what are the purposes of the EU today. They're both related for the reasons that I've set out, I think. The idea that the rationale of the EU is closely related to how we get out of the crisis situation that the EU is in today, but also for the longer term and even before the present crisis. But the immediate issue of the current crisis and how to get out of it, or what the EU is doing with the view to, you know, moving forward and getting out of the current crisis, I think it's clear that from the point of view of popular legitimacy, that the EU can't be associated only or mainly with policies that bring intolerable economic and social hardship for populations, even if those policies are intended to right the wrongs and mistakes which gave rise originally to the crisis. It seems likely that the path of unrelenting austerity, which has been pursued for quite some time now, will significantly damage the prospects of the EU as a future legitimate political system. Even if it seems to be the right response economically, it's clearly not the response that will bring with it the political legitimation, the popular consent that's necessary to make this move out of the crisis a successful one. It's not only hastening the process of alienating voters and citizens from the EU, but arguably it also is beginning to undermine the global role and reputation of the EU as offering a distinctive and alternative social model to the variety of deregulated capitalism that's seen in the US, or the other models of state capitalism now rising in China and other parts of Asia. And so in that sense, I think that the program of closer European fiscal and political integration, even if incremental, is not likely to succeed in mobilizing popular support and will if there's an excessive focus on austerity and not a greater focus than there has been until, at least until very recently on growth, investment, and on welfare. But moving to the second issue, that's a comment simply on the current moment and the immediate steps being taken to try to respond to the causes of the crisis and to move beyond it. The second issue, the more difficult one, is that even if there is some softening of fiscal discipline pursued by the EU and some beginnings of an emphasis on growth and investment and welfare, even if the default disintegration scenario is avoided and the EU sets itself on a firmer and more publicly supported and acceptable path out of the crisis, we still find ourselves in the position that I've been describing already. In other words, at best, we're in the situation of an EU which is not on the brink of collapse, which has delivered many of the benefits for which it was first established, but whose raison d'etre remains in question and which suffers still from a popular legitimacy crisis. The rise of the Euroscepticism and anti-European parties isn't the only manifestation of the lack of social support for the EU. There are many others, including decreasing turnout for elections and so on. And all these testify to the ongoing legitimacy problems of the EU. And so that's the main argument I'm trying to make in the lecture, that is that you know, if the EU is to progress, not just to get out of the current crisis, but if the continuing project of integration is to succeed and to mobilise popular support behind it, there needs to be a more clearly understood and better articulated sense of the EU's contemporary purpose and rationale, such as we'd be capable of gathering that support and allegiance. So let me move on to that question then of the more continuous, less immediate crisis moment, but the more continuous underlying malaise of the EU in the guise of its weak legitimacy and lack of a clear raison d'etre. So last year, in an editorial comment in the European Journal of International Law, another former director of this academy, Joseph Weiler, presented the EU's three major failings as the lack of strong democracy, the lack of capacity and resolve, and the slide in the legitimacy and mobilizing force of the EU and its institutions. And he argued, an interesting argument, that the European Union's, the European Community's founding tendency was one to legitimate itself by what he called political messianism, messiah-like goals, by which he meant the pursuit of a mission, these three ideals of peace, prosperity, and supranationality, you know, goals that were articulated by an elite but did not originate in popular consent or in ordinary political processes. And so he compares this founding tendency of the EU, its political messianism, its tendency to legitimate itself by pursuing a mission. He contrasts it with the ordinary democratic constitutionalism of modern nation states. And the gist of his argument, you know, a gloomy argument, I think, is that this kind of political messianism, however necessary it might have been or seemed at the onset, at the outset of the European project, is always doomed to collapse. And that if Europe can't shift the foundations of its legitimacy from the pursuit of ideals to regular, ordinary process democracy, then it is going to continue its downward slide. So he's contrasting ordinary democratic constitutionalism of modern states with the elite-driven ideal project of the EU polity. And he says the EU is doomed to fail if it doesn't transform itself or transform its mode of legitimation into that of modern democratic states. So the part of Weiler's argument that I think is unquestionable is that the EU does lack the robust democratic legitimacy of nation states, and that its popular and social legitimacy has continued to slide over the last two decades. But at the same time, I want to argue that despite the inevitable complications that greater democratization would bring, and despite most people would readily concede that the EU unquestionably needs to strengthen its democratic foundations and processes, but despite this, the idea that the EU's legitimacy could and should be based simply or primarily on ordinary democratic processes seems to me to be at best premature and maybe even mistaken in the longer term. So I think that despite six decades of existence, the EU remains very significantly different from a nation state in many respects, including in relation to the source of its policy legitimacy. It's polity, not policy legitimacy. Unlike a state, the EU can't, certainly not in its present state of development, rely on ordinary democratic processes, that's obvious, or some form of democratic constitutional patriotism to ground its legitimacy as a polity. That would just be fanciful given what we know about political support for the EU at present. But whether the EU does eventually evolve into a more tightly integrated federal system which could found its legitimacy on ordinary process democracy, I think that remains to be seen, though there are lots of challenges to that deeper vision of political integration for Europe. But I think that for now, at least, as a complex and continually evolving transnational political system composed of at least semi-sovereign nation states, I think the EU still needs to articulate its mission in a way that's likely to generate and mobilize support of its citizens. The kind of citizen identification and social support for the EU political system has largely been missing from what's still, I think, seen as an elite project of integration. And as I said, if the EU wants to command the kind of support and legitimacy that a powerful transnational economic and political system of the kind that it is, not a nation state, not an international organization, but this beast, the sui generis beast that we constantly struggle to define, it does need to articulate a specific raison d'etre. Weiler can call it political messianism, but it needs to identify a purpose and a set of goals that can mobilize the support of citizens, and it can't rely simply on democratic constitutionalism. As I already suggested, that nation states are complete political communities. They have common histories, identities, narratives of origin, and so on. And it's not plausible to think that the EU at its current stage of development could rely on anything like that. So the term political messianism has unattractive connotations, and it seems a pejorative way to me of expressing the idea that a novel transnational political system should articulate its ideals and its values. Indeed, I think somebody who said much the same thing as Weiler did recently, a journalist in the Financial Times, Martin Wolf, argued something similar, but in a very different tone and with different implications. And he said that the fact that the EU is based on an ideal is what actually helps to explain its survival and its resilience at the moment in the face of such strong economic and political centrifugal forces. The forces that are pulling it apart, in other words, are economic. All the economic arguments at the moment point towards disintegration. Even the political arguments in terms of democratic support point towards disintegration. And it's only some underlying ideal that explains the resilience and determination to keep the EU together. The reason why Angela Merkel, for all the domestic political opposition she faces, is determined not to let Europe fail. And he says, I'll read his words, the principal political force is the commitment to the ideal of an integrated Europe, along with the huge investment of the elite in that project. This enormously important motivation is underestimated significantly by outsiders. That was nice to read from the United States, explaining why they're constantly predicting the immediate demise of the EU. While the Eurozone is not a country, it's much more than a currency union. Also for Germany, the most important member, the Eurozone is simply the capstone of a process of integration with its neighbors that has helped to bring stability and prosperity after the disasters of the first half of the 20th century. So his argument is that what Weiler calls the messianic, the commitment to an ideal, is in fact fundamentally what fundamentally and most powerfully drives the European integration process. And he goes on to say something else that I want to focus on in the last part of the lecture. And that is that the big idea that brings the members of the EU together, he says, is that of their place within Europe and within the world. So what I want to do in the remainder of the lecture is to try to elaborate a little bit on that double idea, that what explains the powerful commitment to European integration in the face of such strong political and economic forces pulling it apart is both the place of states and their citizens within Europe and the place of Europe within the world, and to see how that double-sided insight can be translated into a clearer, better articulation of Europe's raison d'etre today. So my argument against Weiler is that the EU does clearly need to articulate its mission in terms that are meaningful to its citizens and its people, many of whom remain substantially alienated from its political system. It needs to articulate a raison d'etre capable of generating and mobilizing popular support, which captures why this system of regional integration and transnational governance still matters. The peace dividend doesn't seem sufficient for younger generations to whom the virtues of supranationalism as an alternative to the nationalism that went before are not so evident. They have no memory of war. That's you, actually. And today confront significant economic uncertainty. So back to the central question, what is then, or how can we think about the raison d'etre of the EU 60 years after the founding of the European Coal and Steel Community? At a time when the EU and everything it's done is sharply in question, how can its mission be convincingly articulated? So I'm suggesting that there's a twofold dimension to the project and process of European integration in contemporary times, the internal and the external dimensions. The first and familiar dimension already discussed, peace, prosperity, supranationality within Europe, the internal dimension, and despite the taken for grantedness of these achievements, remain, I think, very important to the continuing legitimacy of the EU. But the second dimension, the external dimension, was very much less in evidence, I think, during the first four decades of European integration, but it's become increasingly significant in recent years. While the first four decades of the European project were understandably primarily focused on building the system and creating an internal market, an internal effective regulatory and political system, a major focus of the EU since the time of the Maastricht Treaty has been with Europe's global role. The Lisbon Treaty most notably contained lots of reforms aimed at strengthening the values, the institutions, and the actors shaping the EU's international relations. And while at first sight it might seem strange or even paradoxical to suggest that what might generate stronger citizen support for the EU is its global role rather than its internal capacity to deliver the social and economic goods that citizens want, I think the two dimensions are actually connected, and I want to suggest that the complementary nature of the two, the internal and the external dimensions of EU action, is crucial. So the EU's global role, in other words, is not just a question of whether it intervenes in Libya or Syria, whether it imposes sanctions on Iran or helps to steer Burma's transition towards democracy. Those are extremely important dimensions of foreign policy, you know, how it influences places and conflicts around the world. But the EU's global role is also very relevant to the people within Europe in more immediate ways than that. So in a highly an increasingly globalized world, the EU's potential to exercise significant global leadership on a range of crucial matters that states can no longer properly address alone, climate change, privacy, internet governance, anti-terrorism, amongst many others, the capacity of the EU to exercise this leadership is very relevant to the lives of EU citizens and not just to the lives of others in distant parts of the world, although it may be equally relevant to those others too. So the argument is that the EU's capacity to exercise significant global leadership on an important range of contemporary issues provides a powerful rationale for the existence of a strong EU today, and a rationale which could help to mobilize citizen support. The EU is not a match for militarily powerful states in foreign policy, but it has exercised important global leadership on matters such as climate change. It continues to export its regulatory standards to many parts of the world. And as the challenges of global interdependence become more acute, the capacity of the EU to exercise international influence on important policy issues on which states can't act effectively alone becomes ever more significant. So writing some months ago in the Financial Times, you can see I'm an avid reader of the Financial Times, Giuliano Amato and Federico Ghisoni drew on Ian Morris's magisterial work called Why the West Rules for Now. That's the threatening undertone of the final two words, to suggest that the need to tackle Ian Morris's, what he calls the five horsemen of the apocalypse, climate change, famine, migration, disease, and state failure, these are the big global challenges, that these and the need to tackle them provides a very powerful reason for the EU's continued existence. So all of these challenges, though they seem external and distant, deeply affect the lives of European citizens, and they're not just the remote foreign policy concerns of elites. The EU has experience internally of coordinating the different interests of sovereign states with a view to addressing common problems. And this experience equips it well to promote similar collective problem-solving processes internationally. Secondly, the EU has sought to develop and project a distinctive character as a global actor in fields such as climate change, development, human rights, and democracy promotion. As an actor that's committed to pursuing collective, coordinated, as well as multilateral solutions to global problems. And in a recent 2012 European Council on Foreign Relations report, which consisted of a scorecard on foreign policy, while the EU did not do well on bilateral relations with powerful states like China and Russia, its foreign policy performance across the board was weakened by the euro crisis, but it scored rather well on a broad range of important multilateral issues, most notably climate change, crisis management, Bretton Woods reform, non-proliferation, human rights at the UN, international criminal court policy, development aid, and global health. This is a very, very critical European Council on Foreign Relations, I should add, so it's not a kind of an insider boosting of the EU's. It's a very sharp critic of the EU's action internationally, usually. A second way in which the internal and external dimensions of EU policy are closely linked to, as I mentioned earlier, is the capacity of the EU to represent to others an alternative geopolitical model to that of the US on the one hand and China and other emerging economies on the other. For all its current woes, the EU remains the largest market in the world. It's still, as I said, a major exporter of regulatory standards, and it's a major trading partner. One of the strongest critiques of the EU's overemphasis on austerity at the moment, from an external perspective too, is, as Abraham Newman put it some weeks ago in Foreign Affairs magazine, it bears negative consequences not just for Europe, but for the world. The politics of austerity prevents Europe from offering an alternative vision of capitalism and globalization to that put forward by the US. Gone is the idea of Europe leading a global third way between laissez-faire capitalism and managed socialism. So this capacity of the EU to offer a third way, a model of social democracy internally, that's a different way of managing economic globalization, is extremely relevant both to the EU and its citizens internally, but also beyond the EU in terms of offering an alternative model. So just to wrap up, I'm suggesting that regardless of the current economic crisis, and even if the EU emerges from this crisis more closely integrated, the EU nonetheless clearly needs to rethink, to articulate, and to assert its mission and its raison d'etre after 60 years of existence. And while I agree with Weiler that the EU unquestionably needs continued democratic reform and strengthening, I don't believe that the ordinary processes of democracy alone can provide the EU today with the kind of legitimacy that nation states enjoy or that it needs to move forward. But I do believe that the capacity to provide both its member states and their citizens with collective power and coordinated problem-solving capacity on the one hand, and to offer an alternative socio-economic and geopolitical model, as well as offering global leadership on some of the most crucial and pressing transnational challenges today, on the other hand, provide a powerful rationale for the EU system and a strong reason for its member states and citizens, not just to fight for its survival, but to strengthen it. Thank you. And I'm very happy at this stage to take questions, comments, if anyone is still awake or still their brains are still functioning in the heat, any reactions that you have. Yeah.
I'm going to add some remarks because from what you were saying, I wasn't really clear whether you referred to the whole dismantlement of the Eurozone throughout the EU. And I look at the problem from different perspectives. If we look at from a citizen's perspective, I must admit that people take things for granted. I was born in Romania, I left in 2007. People do not know what the four fundamental freedoms is. And I'm not even sure that a lot of people who are not my age in this room know it, because a lot of these countries entered the EU or the community a long time ago, and they don't know what it means to have a passport when you cross the border, when you have work restrictions. So from this point of view, I think public awareness should be raised that a lot of things are taken for granted, but this, I do not think will disappear. If the euro as a currency will disappear, I would not be totally against it. I do not think that if Greece, let's say, defaults, it will mean that they will have to exit the European Union, but not that they exit the Eurozone. But I do think that the Euro project as such was a project that was not well thought of. I do commend certain states like Denmark that opposed the introduction of the Euro as a currency, because they probably felt that something was not thought for properly. From this perspective, I think the EU, for the current time, would be better to be in a position actually like Norway. It's not an EU member. It's not the agreement. It enjoys a lot of fundamental EU freedoms, but then again, it still has sovereignty over really key issues of their economy. Because until you do not have proper political body having power over such elementary things as who prints money when the economy and inflation goes up, which national bank has to handle what, until that political consensus is not reached, I do not think there is space to move towards more integration. The EU will never be the United States. I think for such a state, you need to have a certain national feeling. Everyone in Europe is first an Italian, German, whatever, and then an EU citizen. Turning to the EU's external, I do have the feeling from what I'm researching out that the EU is a bit trying to act like the United States when it comes to its external relations. It tries imposing certain standards on developing countries that in many times the EU does not in itself recognize. A lot of the EU member states have not adopted certain agreements which they actually ask third states to adopt. And Also, I think there's right now, from the EU's point of view, there's no clear image of what's happening during the crisis. The only person I saw till now actually putting her fist up was Angela Merkel. I do not see Helmut von Rompuy, I do not see José Manuel Barroso, and that's where the EU should work as well, to tell the citizens, yes, we need this, and put it in a negative way. You think it's bad, it can be worse, let's go back the way it was before, and you do not want it. And so the citizens have to understand what they will lose, but then again, I do not see one firm leader from any of the EU institutions putting his face down and telling, yes, this is what has to be done.
So, yeah, there are many points to your question or your comment, but one being, you know, the euro can disappear. The euro, I think there's a broad consensus that the euro was premature, was founded on insufficient foundations, and so on. But the question now is, if the euro disappears, can the damage be contained? And that, I think, that's why I said I'm not a psychic. You say the EU will continue. Many others say no chance. You know, those who are involved in the economy more centrally, that it will really be the gradual end of the euro, because much of what it has provided and so on is the economic damage of the breakup of the euro will be excessive. So one problem is we are where we are and we can't undo the past and how we move forward. And you seem to be saying in your question or your comment that, you know, we need something more. I think I hear you say we need something more centralized, because none of the leaders, I mean, Merkel is a nation state leader, not an EU leader, and so she's the main leader of the EU at the moment. We don't see Van Rompuy, they don't have the voice to speak for all of the states. So that requires political integration. And also, I wonder whether, you know, so then you're saying, in other words, we need closer political integration. And again, the paradox is we can't move towards that unless you can bring the citizens with you. And you say they need to be told what have, you know, what's been, what they've won. But that has been a course for a very long time. Why don't the citizens realize what a good thing Europe is? And they don't. The EU institution, it spends a fortune on glossy brochures. It spends a fortune on glossy websites, but they don't do the work at all. Maybe it's a failure of communications, but I feel it's like it's a failure of something deeper. But certainly there's a gap between what the EU has delivered and how citizens, as you say, not just in the, you know, old member states, but in others see it. I spoke last night to some Italian business people, and I thought, presumably they at least, well, because business people usually don't want the euro to fail. They said, the EU has brought us nothing. You know, I was shocked to hear that the EU has brought us nothing. Yeah, we would continue as before. We were able to export and import our goods before, you know, the European Union. So there's a really strong sense of, you know, citizen alienation and not seeing the benefits. And I don't know how that can be overcome. Whether the EU could continue to be a successful entity, it's very hard to reverse now, to get out of having the euro without something more catastrophic happening. On the other hand, it's an interesting thought experiment. If we hadn't had the euro, would we have as, you know, economically successful and integrated, you know, a market, because, you know, the euro was lowering transaction costs and many other things. So, you know, it's an interesting thought experiment. The problem is we've come too far, and what's the Macbeth thing, returning, whereas easier, no, we've come so far, we're so far steeped in blood that should we go no more, returning, whereas difficult as to go or. So you have to keep going, even though you should not have started in the first place.
I have a follow-up question to what you said. In your core thesis is the EU is to get out of the crisis, then there must be, or the citizens must have a better sense for what it's good at, what its values are. So would you think it's a question of marketing, communication, as you just said, or maybe is that insufficient, maybe a different set of values and a different set of things at which the EU is good at is necessary. Because if I think of, consumer protection, environment, anti-discrimination law, human rights, so we probably could agree that the EU does a quite decent job in these fields, and these are things which are important in the political discourse of every European nation state. And so what is really the problem there?
Yeah, I mean, it's the million-dollar question that we've been grappling with. People, you know, all of you here would count as the elite, I'm afraid, because you're educated, you're learning about what the EU is about and for and so on. You're graduates at a certain level. And the problem is, why is it that consciousness amongst European elites hasn't filtered anywhere else, hasn't filtered down? And, you know, is it a question of communication, better communication? I mean, this has been the EU's own, the Commission's own prognosis for years, and what they have tried to do is invest more, but what they do doesn't work, you know, so the endless brochures and websites and so on is not communicating that message, and the message, the strengthening, paradoxically, of domestic political institutions has to be part of it. The more, you know, the clearer articulating by domestic political institutions of what is Europe about and so on, and what comes from Europe and what doesn't. But in some way that is not seen or felt, that the bad thing, the good things Europe does are not noticed or appreciated or taken for granted. The bad things it does are felt very sharply, and others are imagined. So, you know, I spoke to someone, this is very anecdotal, I spoke to someone who makes political videos, and he said to me he'd never really thought about the EU much in the past, but it started because he was working for someone who was running for the European Parliament. And he's made very successful campaign videos for political parties in Ireland, and he said that the EU's, you know, political communication is appalling, and that he looked at them and that they are just so removed and so uninformative and so unhelpful, and that what they need, and he had an idea of an ad with an old couple sitting beside a German and a French person in their 80s talking about, you know, it seems very retrospective, but in a way, something like that that captures, you know, the essence of what the EU was about, that's more real, that's more immediate and so on. Maybe it is just a failure of communication, but if it's one, it's a very intractable one, and one that has never been adequately resolved. Like you, I don't feel like changing values is any part of the problem. It's more about changing an understanding of what the EU has done and can do, both domestically and globally. I should probably bring in others and I'll come back. Yeah.
Yeah. Thank you, friend. Very nice metric. It seems to me, not to harp on about historical mistakes, but this is the main problem with the EU is, as you said, the elites are bringing things to people that they don't want. That's the main problem. Coming from a state of Sweden that probably entered the EU on wrong premises only for financial reasons, you sometimes hear about a two-tier system. And for me, it seems like for Central Europe, federalism is the only way. And there are many countries where you can say that we could never agree to that. Would you think that a two-tier EU system is even possible, or is that very possible?
Don't we have one at the moment? I mean, the EU has always been, it's more clearly a several-tier system now than in the past. Whether it's a good thing to entrench that further or to make the lines clearer, in some ways it's a sort of a blurred multi-tier system. People belong to the euro or to the Schengen, what used to be Schengen, and so on. There are, you know, degrees of belonging. The newer member states were kept out from parts of the internal market, from free movement and so on. So there have been many tiers and circles. The question is whether that's copper fastened in some way. The euro is the most visible example, but you know, there's always been the promise that everyone can always eventually join, and you know, to me there's nothing wrong with that model of partial belonging, multiple belonging, and different with different policies, so long as there are some core policies and where there are no objections, as there were with the EU opting out of social policy years ago, that this is somehow anti-competitive, but rather, or getting a competitive advantage, but rather that there, you know, it makes sense that states can choose the degree and nature and extent of integration, so long as it doesn't affect the functioning of the core political institutions, which have to function on the basis of equality. So it takes some imagining to think of the architecture, but I don't think as a vision that it's far away from what we have or that it's objectionable in itself. But I can see that there might be problems in how it would be managed institutionally, and also perceptions of belonging, that it would always have to be potentially open to all, rather than having these second-class members and first-class members.
Yeah. Yeah, you were talking about the disintegration option. However, as a paradox, the EU is getting ready
So how much room for enlargement is there in the EU, and what do we make of the fact that there are some states still, the Balkans, in particular Western Balkans, waiting to accede? I mean, that's always been a sort of a glimmer of light on the horizon. Someone still wants to be a member of the EU, as everyone else is discussing whether Greece will exit or whether the UK at the present will renegotiate its relationship, I think is the polite term. But, I do think... This is a personal perspective, again, like things like the euro, there's no, will it break up or not? There's no way of, there's no right or wrong answer to these, they're just different perspectives. But I think that enlargement has benefited Europe, and I think it's been a positive thing for many, many reasons. It's been a challenge, everything brings, it's brought lots of challenges, but I think it's been immensely beneficial. There are questions like, should Turkey accede, on which people have incredibly divided views for different reasons. I'm a believer that Turkey should accede. Many other people think not, but Europe isn't an infinite geographic region, so there's no risk of infinite geographic expansion. But I think given that the discussion of Norway, as it exists, the EU is a core with many associated regions. There are many, the EEA and the Mediterranean region, and so it has degrees of economic and political integration with other areas around it. And so, the distinction between those forms of membership and full membership, or those forms of association and membership, are matters of degree. So I am heartened by, the sight that there are countries still which perceive it to be in their interest and what they want politically and domestically to join the EU. And yeah, don't see that that's something that should... that should stop now in a moment of crisis.
Thank you for your lecture. I was reminded me of a quote by a Belgian politician, which we probably...
Oh no! Don't compare me to a politician.
No,
least of all a Belgian.
Europe is an economic giant, political dwarf, and a military worm. And basically, you're saying you have to strengthen political dwarf as we've established the economic giant. But I was wondering how realistic it really is, considering like UK, Denmark versus Germany and France. So on the one side, the big integrationists, and on the other side, people who are sitting on the graves, basically. And that led me on to think, well, the benefits before of your internal dimension, which you see completed after 60 years, that sort of had direct effects on each citizen. Now the external dimension, which you are seeing as a way forward, to have a new raison d'etre, as you call it. I think it's really too remote from the citizen. I mean, like some global governance treaties in Rio, how is that going to affect the citizens of Europe? So I think, again, it's probably it's an elitist approach, but I think the normal citizen won't appreciate it.
Okay, so two questions, really. One about... this global role, isn't it too remote to really have any mobilizing potential or legitimizing potential? And the other, how could there be further political, how could we strengthen the political dimension given the great differences? Maybe one answer to the strengthening the political is, as the previous speaker asked, having a more committed core for now. I mean, that has been de facto the situation, as we've seen in many ways. So the UK has been in some ways a partial, a semi-detached actor at times in different contexts. I think a successful, strengthened, politically integrated Europe would attract rather than shed. I mean, maybe in the end it would shed members, maybe that would happen, but maybe it would also attract others. But I do think that the muddling through with the very weak political dimension and the strong economic dimension and how that has come undone in recent years really does point to the need for a stronger political dimension. I don't think there's any alternative to that. And if it means a different relationship with Denmark and Britain, maybe that will not be a bad thing in the longer run. Again, it's hard to tell. On the elite nature, you're right, of course, who cares about global governance at one level? But all these things have a very, they are felt domestically. So you know, climate change is about Rio on the one hand, but it's also about, you know, having to pay for your waste or having to change the gas you use in your car and whether your children, you know, eat certain kinds of foods. And, you know, there are all kinds of ways. It's hard to, again, it's the problem of community, it's hard to translate how important it is to have a strong voice globally on issues of major concern that affect everyone's lives, you know, anti-terrorism, another, privacy, whether when you Google you're being tracked and so on, and how your life functions. I mean, these things, the kinds of standards, the regulatory standards the EU sets enormously impact on people's lives and the food they eat and the quality of the air around them and so on. So again, it's a problem of, maybe you're saying, and it could be, these are all elite issues anyway. That's always the argument in the US, that nobody, you know, people don't, they care about their jobs and their taxes. They don't care about the environment and others. I don't really believe that. And I, you know, I do think there's a problem of communication doesn't seem to me to capture it, but a problem of the filtering down of the understanding of what the relation is between the European entity and the way people live their lives and how policies come into being and affect their lives. So, I mean, people, you know, the EU used to do things like, we all know, well, I know it coming from Ireland, but it has signs up saying, you know, built by EU funds for nice roads and things like that. But, you know, I think that it's surprising the kind of the extent to which maybe, you know, my colleague from Bulgaria, was it a roommate? Denmark, okay, said that actually people do at certain times recognize and appreciate what the EU has done, but it's somehow translating that into a broader understanding of the EU as a political system being part of what the everyday policies that govern your lives are, that somehow always been so difficult, the disconnect between the local, domestic, and the supranational, that's been so difficult and so undermining of European legitimacy.
I'm slightly confused now, because I seem to have understood from your speech that what you were claiming for is a deeper reflection from your side on its rationality. And what I'm hearing here now is that there is a communication problem. So the problem lies in between. There is a communication problem, but also Europe needs to rethink itself in a way. Maybe it's a very basic question, but I wanted to ask you, where do you see mostly the problem? What is the biggest issue?
It's an interesting reflection and a helpful one, so that I'm saying we need to rearticulate maybe a new, but certainly an updated version of the EU's raison d'etre, and you're saying you're hearing from the floor something different, people saying actually what it's doing is fine, it's just that people don't understand it. Yeah, that almost suggests to me, maybe this is wrong, but that we may be somewhere between what I'm suggesting, the messianic ideal driven integration and the domestic political processes, that many of you are saying, well, how the EU is acting, what it's doing and what it's delivering should be enough to gather and garner political support, but that's somehow not felt. And, you know, I'm saying it is not enough because it's palpably currently evident that it's not enough, and therefore the communication issue has not been resolved. We haven't managed to find a way of telling the people, you know, how good it is and so on, and that somehow, you know, the idea of Europe as nothing has ever provided as powerful and compelling a rationale for European integration as peace. You know, nothing has provided that. And that somehow, you know, this is like a modernized version of the continuation of peace. It's a global issue too. You know, I'm trying to articulate something. There's no war now and we're not threatened by war. Even the Balkans war is fading in memory. So it's not an issue anymore that Europe protects us against war, but that Europe is a necessary part of a stable global system where we're all very interconnected and there are many, you know, different threats, or not just threats, challenges and so on, and that it's a necessary part of that. But it may be that we need both of these things. We need better communication, we need better articulation, we need a modernized understanding of Europe's rationale, Europe's raison d'etre, and also that somehow there may be a process of transition from something that really is a functional, elite-driven, top-down system to a bottom-up, democratic, self-evidently self-legitimating political entity, but that we're somewhere in transition between those. That's a that's an attempt to explain why there seems to be a communication. It might be wrong, but it's one possibility. Yeah, so I'll come to you after, yeah.
You were saying that peace and prosperity were achieved by the European integration. Are peace and prosperity objectives that can be achieved also if they are maintained?
Mm.
So if the European Union would disintegrate now, which guarantees would we have that another war wouldn't start between France and Germany? And I think I have a small example to illustrate that. There was a couple of years ago, there was a conflict between Hungary and Slovakia. The Slovakia prohibited the Hungarian president to enter Slovakia on the Hungarian
national. Yeah.
And I'm sure that some years ago, there would have been at least a skirmish.
Right.
But, I mean, war started because less than that. But instead of that, there was an infringement procedure.
Right, by the commission, yeah.
Which is definitely a far more civilized way to resolve a conflict. I don't know if the conflict was like really solved, but at least you didn't have a war, but you have
Civilized procedures. I think you should write an article about this. I think it's fascinating. No, really, I heard someone else from the Slovak foreign ministry talking about it, and it's precisely this, you know, apparently ridiculous but very potent conflict where, you know, the refusal to allow a head of state to come and visit the neighboring state and to see it resolved through, I mean, that's everyone's, you know, ideal of, that's what the civilizing idea of international organizations is supposed to be, that things get resolved through, you know, litigation rather than through through war or through an escalation of diplomatic conflict leading to hostility and so on. And it is a good example. Again, though, we're back to the same problem of, you know, the feeling in the room, maybe there are others, it'd be interesting to hear counter voices, but the idea that peace, prosperity, and supranationality are enough and that they take work to be maintained, and the reason why we have them is because the EU exists, and they might go away if the EU didn't exist. But that's a difficult one to, somehow, it's a difficult one to sell. It doesn't seem to translate into popular support. It doesn't seem to translate. It's not evident that either, it can't be that people don't value peace, right? So it must be in some way that they don't connect the existence of the EU with the relatively peaceful and until recently relatively prosperous and stable functioning system. But maybe telling some of these stories is one way of addressing that. You know, telling some of these stories is one way of highlighting the extent to which establishing European institutions and processes and so on has enabled states to live together in relative harmony rather than in constant conflict. Oh, sorry.
This story is easier to sell in Central and Eastern Europe than in Western Europe, right? Because in Eastern or Central Europe, people, well, even if they didn't live through war, but they have, I think, a better feeling.
Yeah.
War and austerity means.
Yeah. It seemed a compelling story to me, but I think you're absolutely right about the differential understandings and meanings and significance of European integration for different populations, especially East and West, and more developed versus less developed, unquestionably. Although, as someone said at a conference I was at last week, that the interesting thing about the crisis, we are all developing nations now. I say that as an Irish person. Yeah.
Back to one of your initial arguments of the stories from the States, where you said that you were considering over there, that Europe was in real crisis, and maybe even the collapse of the euro would mean that the euro could not exist anymore. And I just find it in a way very difficult quite to understand this thought experiment or what that means when people from the States say that and when this is discussed, because if you think about it now, consider the role of the EU now, you have thousands and thousands and thousands of pieces of EU legislation which has been implemented by all 27 countries. They have legal scholars who work with EU law and all 27 countries, judges, ministries, all kinds of central administrations working on EU law within, I suppose, that the quantity of EU law is bigger than the national law. So the EU has already made a very strong influence on all countries. So if we imagine that the euro should collapse, we would still have EU law deeply scattered around the countries. And it's just difficult for me to understand how that's... As long as we have a court of justice and a commission and a parliament, we have so much EU law already all around, which means that in substance there might be a collapse of the euro for time or something, or whatever that would... That means the end of the European Union. Well, I should never say never, but still, I just find it, particularly as to the reaction from the state where they say, will this collapse? The European Union will collapse, yeah, but if it collapses, what would happen? You have EU law all over the place, people will comply.
So it's again an interesting observation. What does it mean to say the EU might collapse, might eventually break apart? We have all of us, everyone who teaches and understands is part of this system, all of the institutions that have built, grown up, and all of the legislation that's now embedded. You know, the reaction I get in the US is, look what happened at the Soviet Union. You know, they say, I was a Russian studies person, Soviet studies person. So it's a joke that is made by many, but they say, they point to me and say, ah, yes, I was once a Soviet studies scholar too. You know, empires rise and fall and so on. So everything is possible. But on the other hand, it's extremely difficult, it's true, in the current circumstances to imagine it would be a long, slow process of unraveling, I imagine, if it were to happen. But, you know, the question, the thing is that we don't know that. There's a lot of commitment to keep the EU together, however strong the market forces. The problem is nobody controls the market, or at least it's very difficult to see how the market can be controlled, and each political move that's made to try to contain, you know, the run on the banks or the spread of, the banking problem from state to state and so on, is it seems to each time the markets, market actors outflank the political steps. So, you know, these are unpredictable times, but, it's nice to hear. It's nice to be in Europe again and to hear more confidence about the future of the EU.
Lecture. I think it's very important that at times like this we reflect and we ask ourselves, what has the EU done and why is it poor? Why do we have it? But in that sense, your rationale has two dimensions that you split between internal and external. I was wondering perhaps if the three elements of the internal perspective have actually been achieved. We all agree that peace is there, but when it comes to prosperity and especially supranationality, I think these are a bit more tricky elements, especially the latter, because had there been more of that, especially in times like this, I think certain mechanisms of decision-making and speed would have been different. But I think we find ourselves in a EU where still the member states, which I'm hearing very little about, are there, and they are, in a way, the masters of the treaty and the engines behind. So in that sense, perhaps I'm looking for the rationale of the EU now and what it needs to do in the future, considering also in its external representation. We have member states which have very different priorities, and we can see that in the representation of the United Nations, we can see that in recognizing third states, which is the case, for example, of Kosovo, and examples continue. So in that sense, I wanted to ask you, how do we actually say, if we're looking at the rationale, the element of supranationality, and in the future, as you play for external?
Very good question. So we gloss over, we all talk about peace and prosperity. What about supranationality? Has it been achieved? I think, you know, what's been achieved is the establishment of a system of transnational governance that is mixed. We have a strong amount of legal supranationality, but much less political supranationality. So maybe part of the response is to say, well, the argument about the need for closer political integration is in a way an argument for greater political supranationality rather than consensus and intergovernmentalism and so on, that political union, what's really meant by that when we talk about closer political integration, is a greater degree of supranational rather than intergovernmental control. So to that extent, we have a lot of supranationality in Europe, but it's again partial or one-sided supranationality. We have very strong legal supranationality with primacy and direct effect and the role of legal institutions. We have more partial political supranationality. And again, though, I feel like we're always caught in the same paradox that to push towards more political supranationality in the face of resistant domestic populations. You know, the fact that no referendum could be got through in any state of Europe at the moment on a proposal like that. I would be surprised, even in the countries of Central and Eastern Europe, would any population accept greater political supranationality for now if it were put to the people? That's always an underlying problem. It seems like the answer that is needed to support the economic integration project and all the benefits that came with the economic integration project, but it is not wanted politically at the grassroots level. So I think it's a very deep problem. If there were an easy solution to this crisis, I feel like we'd have found it.
So we'd like to reinforce the issue that it is a kind of catch-22 situation. So as long as you have national states managing the perception of people in terms of what the needs and values are, it will be difficult for it to come to a different situation. Maybe a referendum easily, but to at least put an issue on the table or can express the view. I have to say my perception is that the position of national population is not that negative in Italy. For example, there is a very, very big issue at the moment in terms of legitimacy of political representation at the national level. People understand exactly, as we miss out of my own family discussions, as to the fact that austerity is put forward. The only question is not between, the question is not the limits, not between not austerity or austerity. The question is what kind of timeline you have to actually reabsorb this equilibrium that has been accumulated for decades. So in that regard, there is also a process that is ongoing. There is really not a lot of debate. For example, just to lay on the fact that national and international political relationships are starting to interact very, very closely together. Mrs. Merkel was in the hostage of acting on this position on the SMGT in her dealing with the claims on the side of Mr. Merkel. So, I also would like to add one other issue. You said before that there is broad agreement on the fact that the euro is not totally conceived, or I disagree on that. I have direct experience of the way in which capital markets have progressed during the last 50 years. As of today, I work for the International Organization for Sustainable Investment Bank, and it's a big bank of economic policy at this moment. 60% of what we have raised in the capital markets this year has been done in euros. So the currency is much more than the dollars. So the currency is in need. Dollar also of is a solid currency from the point of view of the capital market infrastructure that has been. And there has been enormous progress in the world. So it seems to me that the issue of political integration is already taking place, that this process of increasing awareness is taking place. What's not taking place is a thematic approach to the decisions that need to be taken at the broad level with regard to the future of political integration. And there is a lot of interest on the side of the national politicians to represent the international to structure the story in such a way that national populations indeed are kept away from this step that would bring them, that would write them out. And if you look, I was just thinking, for example, at the way which Spinelli and Gombotti described national interests in their manifest in 1945, you find exactly description of things that correspond to the current situation at this moment. The subject is a different. And with regard to the final point, also with regard to the let's say sense or content of this political unity and work of the EU, there is an aspect which is which relates indeed to not to the control but to the dealing with capital markets. And it is apparent to everybody that the issues posed by capital markets at this moment are not issues that the national states can deal with. So the EU, even before talking about climate change, is positioning itself. The union, not intended as the Commission, but the union as a project, as an ongoing project, is positioning itself as a way to exactly deal with these issues that could otherwise not be there.
Yeah, I mean, again, it's, you know, I'm sort of heartened in a way to hear so many positive interpretations of what's happening. Although in a way, we're not contradicting each other in terms of, you know, the argument that the euro was misconceived as it sort of was that it was a project of, it was an economic project which the markets and the capital markets, as you say, welcome, and that it is functioning successfully, but that politically there was not the political underpinning. So, you know, what went wrong in Greece was inadequate, you know, supervision of what was being reported and so on, inadequate political control, in a sense, over what is happening in various member states. And then many others, a failure of banking, adequate banking regulation, many different regulatory and other kinds of political failures, which has brought the euro down or is bringing the euro down at present. But so you're saying as a currency, it's not necessarily problematic, or it wasn't a mistake. But your core point seems to be, I think, that not so much a failure as the other speakers have suggested, maybe it's a failure of communication, thinking of communication from the EU about its own merits, nor even a failure, a lack of communication domestically, but a deliberate misinformation, if that's what I hear you say. Yeah, so that's very interesting that the, I mean, I can imagine that certainly from a media point of view, and depending, you know, that the media is very powerful, and the way in which the story is told, and I suppose the close link between the media and political circles makes that a plausible scenario. But I would be interested to hear more about what the different reasons are for a different political story to be told, because in many ways, the political elites themselves, in many, most countries, even, you know, Denmark and the UK in different ways, are supportive of the project of European integration. So why is it that the story they are telling, is it for short-term reasons, medium-term reasons? Why is the story that they're telling one that undermines or undersells the European project? Maybe this is the subject for a longer conversation. But, so let me just see, is there anyone else who hasn't spoken yet?
Okay. Thank you once more for your lecture. I interpreted to some extent your intervention as a functional lecture of your integration process. And then my question is that the vision of the European Union as a sort of institutional level, a needed institutional level, on one end to mediate the participation of member states in the world political arena, on the other maybe to reach this scale effect in regulating the regulatory capitalism, does not lead to leave apart, let's say, the concept of the EU as a legal order expressed on one end in public laws and the other in Cardiff, for instance, doesn't lead to representing EU as an institutional level, not a legal order.
I'm not sure I fully understand the question. I might put it back to you again, but I think you're saying that the vision I'm presenting of the EU as a mediator between the global and the domestic, and between the states and the EU in terms of addressing common problems, leaves out the dimension of the EU as a legal order. Is that right? But can you say a little bit more about what you mean by that? Yeah.
A political legal order. I mentioned just two famous cases, just to say that there, to some extent, I mean, also talking about internal role of the European Union institution, I said before, as a regulatory technocratic.
Right, right.
Let's say, to some extent, at least it's my interpretation, exclude the vision of the EU political order. I mean, it concentrates the attention on the
legal
institutional needs that, to some extent, legitimize the European Union institutions.
So I may not be answering your question properly. I'm still not sure I've fully get the connection between the legal and political, but if maybe something that you're saying, or at least something that it made me think of, is that the EU acts as a legal actor in all kinds of ways too, as well as a political actor, and to some extent these legal institutions are quite autonomous, like the internal development of direct effect and primacy, and you use the Caddy case as the external example, and I think you're certainly right in that. I was at a conference last week in the US on the Caddy, not the Caddy case, that's a good Freudian slip, on smart sanctions, on targeted sanctions, with people from Europe, from the European institutions, and people from the US, and it was astonishing to see the impact that the case has had. And that's the Court of Justice. It's not the Council, it's not the Commission, it's not Merkel, it's not anybody else, it's the Court. And a woman from the US State Department said to me, I said something about the lack of interest in Europe, you know, from the point of view, and she said, you must be joking. She said, we have 20 different departments of the government that is busily reading all, he said, we never looked at a European court case before, and now they're regularly reading all the European case law, so it's been an educational process for them. But in other words, just to point out that there are ways in which the EU, the legal construction of the EU acts on the world globally and domestically that are not neatly integrated into the political picture I've been presenting. I don't know whether that's responsive to your question or not. I see we're out of time. I want to apologize to the two who had their hands up, but I thought I should bring in new speakers rather than return to those. But thank you all for very interesting and heartening reflections on a difficult time for Europe.
Thank you. Thank you very much indeed for this very interesting, extremely interesting lecture and the engaging discussion that follows. Thank you again. Now you have a visit, I think, at the European Institute Library, and tomorrow we continue the course. Thank you again.